China, a country as vast as a continent, with the largest population on Earth. A nation of contrasts. Its central interior dissected by Asia's longest rivers. Its western border regions ringed by ice and desert. The eastern provinces are home to its most populated cities, with more people than the whole of the United States. The world's biggest ports and the greatest manufacturer of goods on Earth. This unique aerial exploration of a diverse nation reveals unseen stories of tradition and modernity. China, a nation industrializing faster than any in human history. China's 18,000 kilometer continental coastline encompasses very diverse environments. From the frigid Bohai Bay in the north to Hainan Island in the far tropical south. The eastern provinces have led the charge in China's dramatic urbanization, pulling in millions of people from the rural areas in just four decades. Nearly half the population, over 600 million, live here. It's now the economic gateway to the rest of the world. Growing prosperity has seen the birth of new cultural, leisure, and environmental interests, unthinkable a few decades ago. At the heart of China's rapid industrialization are billion-dollar infrastructure projects, connecting cities and regions with extensive road and rail networks. On the southeast coast is one of China's most ambitious engineering projects, the longest sea bridge on Earth. It connects three major cities across the vast 50-kilometer Pearl Delta, a sea inlet battered by typhoons, home to one of the busiest ports in the world. Hong Kong, via Macau and Zhuhai, is now connected straight to China's manufacturing heartland, Guangdong, home to 100 million people. It's made of enough steel to build 60 Eiffel Towers, as much concrete to fill 400 Olympic-sized swimming pools, and is now near completion, due to open in 2018 to road traffic. Surveyors Li Shulian and Xiong Jinhai are helping to oversee the completion.
港珠大桥通车以后，原来从香港到珠海的这个时间，由原来的三个小时将会缩短为30分钟。
This 38-kilometer long triple span structure, 20 times that of the length of the Golden Gate Bridge, has to withstand a strike from a 300,000-ton vessel. A magnitude 8 earthquake, and resist the extreme tropical climate, including typhoons. It's also China's first major combined bridge and tunnel sea crossing project. Smaller ships can sail under, but to allow giant container ships passage to the South China Sea. The engineers came up with an imaginative solution. A road traffic tunnel under the sea. But the only way to connect the traffic from a road bridge to a submerged tunnel was to build two artificial islands at either end. These are propped up by 120 18-story steel cylinders. In between is an almost 7-kilometer tunnel comprised of 33 giant tubes connected together on the sea floor. It's now time for the finishing touches. Work on this 7-year-long construction has been dangerous for many. And others have sacrificed more than safety. 52-year-old Sean was one of the original 13 staff who joined in the project's infancy. One way around these long separations is to marry someone on the job.
来到大桥差不多四年，我11年来到大桥，15年结婚，然后16年有了自己的小孩，就整个的自己的大事情，基本上就是在这个大桥上来完成的。The
Chinese government hoped that this $17 billion bridge will draw together 9 southern cities into one giant manufacturing hub. Only time will tell whether the economic benefits are realized. Despite the accelerated march of industrialization in China, in the northeastern province of Jilin lies Chagan Lake, where some ancient methods of production are so effective they remain unchanged. The freshwater lake is 500 square kilometers, the largest in the province. The winter's deep freeze makes agriculture and fishing almost impossible. Temperatures get as low as minus 22 Celsius, turning rivers and lakes into frozen wildernesses. The sea is over 600 kilometers to the south, but the local people here are still able to catch thousands of kilos of fish in the depths of winter. By using a 1,000-year-old ethnic Mongolian technique, they are able to catch the fish on an industrial scale, with just horse and human power. Zhang Wen is the fishing master. Fifty men will spend the whole morning laying the net under half a meter of thick ice.
我这网啊，我们这个网非常大，2000米，你没有技术，你做不了这个鱼把头。咱们是在水下作业的东西，但是呢，你在冰上是看不见的，底下是摸不到的，所以说呢，这种技术是非常了不得的，了不起的。做一个鱼把头，必须得具备能有技术。
They start by cutting a series of holes they can feed the net through.
完了，把网那个窜杆下去，后边带着水线就走了，后边带着一个网涛。这网涛拴的是啥呢？拴的是网。网涛下去以后，用马轮子绞这个涛。They
still use horsepower to turn a wooden winch, gradually hauling the net into place.
This, so 我们不用计划，用网拉绞盘，说它的能量是最大的。我们整了这个网啊，出网、下网，那就往前走，都是我们用网拉的绞盘来工作的，所以说不用机械化，也不用人力，所以说它的能量非常大。
In past years, they have caught over 160 tons of fish from below the ice in the winter season.
啊，俩人并排扔了都打呗，不是七梗的是吧？
And each year, they hope to better the previous year's catch. As the dusk approaches, the spindle makes its final turn, and the net is drawn back up through an ice hole.It's brimming with carp and other freshwater species.
This is a big harvest.大概能有一两万斤吧。
The fishermen will be back tomorrow and will continue for another month. China has always relied on its natural resources to help provide for its vast population. In fact, they are a world leader when it comes to harnessing the elements.As they now have higher power demands than any other nation on Earth. And more of it is coming from an infinite coastal energy resource, wind power. China's coastal waters have some of the highest average wind speeds in the world. Just north of Shanghai is China's largest offshore wind farm, Rudong.It has almost 100 turbines operating in shallow water, just 8 kilometers from the shore. And this farm isn't yet complete, with 16 turbines left to erect. China is relatively new to offshore turbines. The first farm started operating at sea in just 2010. Senior manager Shen Juchuan.Was commandeered to turn his shipbuilding skills to turbine installation. He had a steep learning curve.
当时我们选用的安装的技术，国内也没有，对我们带来了很多的一些技术难题。
The process begins with the individual sections being transported by barges to its seabed location. In all.20 specially adapted vessels are used in the operation when the tide and weather allows. The metal parts themselves are rust and salt resistant. Another customized barge awaits delivery, stationing itself with 4 hydraulic pillars to the seabed, ready to assemble the turbine piece by piece, with 2 cranes with a load capacity of 1,300 tons.A team of 50 live on this platform during the process, which takes 3 to 4 days to complete.
海上的生活，这是对每个人是必须要过的这个坎。假如说你过不了这个坎，可能就建设方面可能会遇到一些问题。
The first phase is to place pillars onto a foundation platform that sits on the seabed, only 5 meters below the surface.The first section of the 219-ton, 70-meter-long pillar is lowered slowly and carefully by the crane operator. But then it has to be guided onto screw threads by hand.
In the 安装过程当中所期盼的一个好天气，那么今天确实从根据气象预报和我们实际的观察。很适合于 一片人叫床。
The top half of the structure is ushered into place with the help of the engineers inside the pillar itself. The men will be enclosed here, but they have access to internal ladders to exit the structure at its base. The next phase connects the three 80-meter-long turbine blades onto its rotating hub, called the impeller.
The 风力发电机，风力发电主要关键的部位，目前就是这个叶片。那么这个设计呢，它总共有三个叶片。也有叫做风能的，它的目的就是使得发电机旋转。
Because of the pressure to beat poor weather, work continues throughout the night to install the 217-ton housing that holds the generator and gearbox that turns wind power into energy. By dawn, this is in place, and it's time for the final stage.To attach the blades, weighing 29 tons each, to a 170-ton wheel hub. Despite all the computer-aided technology, human guidance is still crucial in fixing together these components.After 3 days of working around the clock, the turbine is complete.
那接下来呢，我们会安排一些电气工程师对里面的电气设备啊进行连线啊，还是交接试验。那通过这些工作以后呢，整个风机呢也可以融入到施工当中。那这样子呢，也是我们把自然的就是海上的风资源转换成电能，输入到就是陆地上的千家万户使用当中。
Now the crew move on to a new installation, and the process starts all over again. As China's economy continues to grow, so does its urban populations, with many people leaving behind rural village life for the lure of the big city. Migration has even led to some places being abandoned, and in one case, a whole village.Has almost returned to nature. Hotuan was once home to a community of 2,000 fishermen and their families. Shunsheng Island lies just 80 kilometers off Shanghai's coast.And is one of 400 that make up the Shunsi Archipelago. It was a struggle to maintain life in such a remote place. And eventually, 20 years ago, the last resident left. It was almost unknown to the outside world.Until Zhou Jie, a 36-year-old doctor from Shanghai, stumbled upon this Chinese Garden of Eden.
第一次来后头玩，因为这个地方给我的一个视觉冲击力首先就很大，因为从了一个比较喧哗的一个闹市，然后一直到了这样一个没有人的，而且都是满目都是一些绿色的这样一个村子。
Jie is also a keen photographer.
所以我想把这种美、这种特别的一种感觉传递给大家，所以我就去拍了这样一些照片。当然拍的时候也没有特别多想，就跟着感觉拍吧。
Her photographs went viral, showing how quickly human ecosystems can be reclaimed by the natural world. Crowds from Shanghai now make the journey to experience this village's return to nature.
首先这个地方景观我觉得就是比较特别的，因为它这么多一个被这样一个绿色所覆盖的一个房子，好像别的地方也没有看到过，它给人整体的感觉就是这种，这样一个大自然的这样一种力量，这种能够吞噬一切的力量，能够使我们敬畏的一种力量。
Encouraged by this tourism, some former residents have now seen an opportunity.
哇，好香啊！你们在烧饭啊？
烧饭。
在炒菜啊？
炒菜。
这有饭吃吗？中午来吃饭行吗？
They were some of the last remaining residents to leave, and now they've started a small restaurant for visitors.
哎，您笑一下。
For the busy hospital doctor,
你和你的村子、你的家乡拍张照。
Photography has always been an escape.
有一些美的东西能够打动我的东西，我就特别愿意去拍它，可能和自己的心境也有关系。
Despite mass migrations, it's not a one-way road from rural to urban China. Hainan Province off the southern coast is a tropical island with a fiery past. In the shadow of the island's Haikou volcano clusters, local Yongxin farmers have struggled with the rocky volcanic soil for generations. The only thing that grew here was the lychee fruit. But making a living was a struggle. But one former villager has returned from the big city and is now dramatically turning around the fortunes of these farmers.Chen Tonghui's family farmed lychee here for generations, which sold cheaply to the local markets. After working as a journalist in Shanghai, he returned to his home village with a plan to go organic and market the lychee to city dwellers at a premium price.
像早期这些荔枝农不愿意合作的时候，我爸当然也是最早支持我的农户之一。
Tong Kui's brother was on hand to help.
我们的农民听到Tong Kui这个有机农业的理念的时候，他们的第一个反应就是不可能。他们觉得，你不打除草剂，然后花那么大的人力去除这个，他们觉得不划不来。
First.He upgraded the basic infrastructure.
在统奎回来之后，修了水塔，修了路，通了电网的改造。那荔枝因为有了灌溉，它长得更好，就会带来很多大的丰收的改变。
The marketing paid off. The lychee sold at 3 times the price in Shanghai, transforming the villagers' fortunes.Many leaving behind their basic housing constructed from volcanic rock for new homes. Now Tong Kui has a new venture to grow something never tried in their volcanic fields. Dragon fruit.
那火山地这个地方呢，确实耕种非常的辛苦啊。我们想找一种水果。它能够适应这种石头地的这个生长。
His brother spent a year constructing trellis walls from the old volcanic rock.
在农业上算高投入，然后按照目前那个产量来说，实际上呢没有达到那种平地种植的产量，但是呢也超出了我的想象，因为确实还长得蛮好的。
Another successful organic harvest is reason to celebrate. Hainan's volcanoes haven't erupted for 84 years. But coastal provinces are subject to other destructive forces of nature, especially typhoons. These massive storms strike China's eastern coast 7 to 8 times every year, sometimes with more ferocity than Atlantic hurricanes. Hangzhou Bay, an inlet of the East China Sea, is home to one of nature's most impressive phenomena, one of the world's largest tidal bores. In typhoon years, this tidal bore can be more destructive. Known as the Silver Dragon in folklore, it's strongest when the gravitational forces of the moon, sun, and earth combine. Some years it reaches 9 meters high. It has caused destruction and loss of lives in the past. Fences now help protect the public during the boar watching festival. Qing Yun is a Chengtang River hydrologist.
自古以来也有观潮的传统啊，以前我们的海塘没有这么结实，那潮水涌进去，因为都是咸水，整片庄稼是四五年都不能耕种的，所以说以前潮水带来的都是灾害，但是到八十年代开始，随着我们工程技术的进步，可能我们能够控制它了。The
bore is caused by the strong autumnal incoming tide being funneled from the wide bay into the narrow neck of the Chengtang River. The outflowing river current then pushes up the bigger incoming wave, creating the powerful bore. A wall of water that runs down the river for 100 kilometers attracts some of the best big wave surfers on the planet.
The tidal bore is really different from the normal wave. It's an amazing experience, you know? It's totally different.
We know the wave's coming. It goes for an hour and 40 minutes, you get 20 goes of it.
在海里面可能一道好的浪也就是几十秒就没有了。我觉得江上跟海里的最大的差距就是在江上一道好的浪你可以冲几公里。
Its destructive power has left a lasting impression on the local Hangzhou people. In a ceremony which legend says goes back 2,000 years, the locals sacrifice animals to keep the silver dragon at bay. Today is a public holiday, the Tide Watching Festival. It attracts up to 170,000 onlookers. Scientists are also keeping a keen electronic eye on the bore from multiple cameras installed along the route.
一共有七个点，从起潮开始是起潮点，只是收集涌潮的高度、涌潮的形态、涌潮潮道的时间，收集这样的一些资料。
Yun is going to get much closer and take a sample of the sediments just after the bore passes through.
我觉得啊，从它本身的高度和壮观程度上来说，可能仅次于我们亚马逊河的永超，但是从它的观赏性来说，我觉得钱塘江永超还是排在世界第一的。
The tide alerts the thousands gathered to watch the giant wall of water collide with a dam. When it bounces back from the wall, a chain of Chinese lanterns traditionally act as the ball's height yardstick.In the end, the scientists hope that their data will help them to predict which years the bore could be at its most destructive.Up the coast, far from the reach of tropical typhoons, more benign tidal forces helped create an industry that was the envy of the West for centuries, and is still important to this day. China's largest salt farm. In a landscape as large and diverse as China's, the natural processes of weathering.Can bring great economic benefits. China's salt lakes and coastal salt farms were a resource that was the envy of other nations. Locations such as Yuanchen Lake, known as the Dead Sea of China, the third largest salt sulfate lake in the world. Famed for its skin healing properties, sulfate salt also combines with algae to produce vivid colors.On the coast, sea salt farms aren't quite as colorful, but they are an important natural resource for China, the world's leading producer and consumer of salt. Bohai Bay, on the northeast coast. Here, the ancient practice of salt farming has been updated for modern times.Chenglu Tenggu Salt Works, which dates back over 1,000 years, is the largest producer in China. It harvests almost 800,000 tons a year from an area almost the size of 1,000 football pitches.
盐业生产呢，靠的是自然的这个风能和太阳能和广阔的滩田的面积。目前呢，汉武盐场的这个滩田的占地面积呢，还有96个平方公里。
Wang Hongqing has seen the industry change since his father's generation worked the salt flats.
小的时候就见证过我的父辈们，他们是怎么产盐。那个过去呢，都是比较落后的那种工艺。大部分就是靠体力来完成的这个工作。
He is part of a new generation who brings modern skills to an ancient practice.
那么到了大学，正好学的是这个专业，从感性上面呢，应该说我对盐场就有一个感性的认识。
Salt used to be harvested once a year in autumn.
那么随着这个技术的进步，我们现在呢逐步形成了常年制垄、常年结晶、季节性收盐的这么一种生产的模式。
The high salt levels of this northeastern coastline produces a stunning visual phenomenon in September. The red beaches of Panjin. It's not the salt that turns red, but a flowering plant called a seepweed. It thrives on the high concentration of salty water in the bay. Part of the Shuangtai Estuary National Reserve, it's also the most extensive bird wetland in all of China. The brackish mudflats attract one of Asia's most endangered and iconic bird species. The 1.5 meter tall red-crowned crane. A team of Chinese conservationists are trying to halt their decline. Zhou Shuwei is rearing cranes from eggs to release back to the wild. Shuwei has several flocks reared at different stages of development.
这就是种鹤，每一年就是通过它们繁殖产蛋，然后咱们进行孵化的。数量之后，像这种鹤的话，也是属于放归大自然的。
The youngest flock, at nearly 3 months, is on the threshold of their most important stage, learning to fly. After feeding, Shuwei releases them to practice.
虽然说现在不能飞呢，但每一次它也要是进行这个锻炼，锻炼起飞的，就是锻炼这个翅膀这个肌肉能力啊和身体这个腿的负重能力。
Some crane species can achieve enormous feats of duration in flight. Migrating nearly 20,000 kilometers and can reach heights over 1,500 meters. A more mature flock can now fly for short distances. Unlike many other birds, cranes are born without the instinct to migrate and will return to their pens. But one day, some of these birds will follow wild cranes and venture further afield. 120 kilometers south, across the bay, is the spiritual and physical center for a Chinese pastime that took to the air and migrated to the rest of the world over a millennium ago. Weifang. It's often called the world capital of kites. It's located on the windswept northeastern province of Shandong. Nine million people live here. But it's best known for its kite district, Yangjiapu. Amongst the 87 kite factories here is Wen Yong Xun's. He has had a passion for kites since he can first remember.
I learned how to make kites.
专业的去学习这个烘技。
What started as a hobby has developed into a thriving business.
原来呢，一开始呢就是设计生产，后来呢就说是生产上规模化。
They produce hundreds of different styles for markets all over the world. Nearly 100 people are in full preparation for the big event of their year. The International Kite Festival set for the next day.
I 这几天呢，一直也非常紧张的忙碌。也一些呢，担心，就说是到那天，天气怎么样？包括放飞的效果怎么样？这会儿有时候晚上做梦，感觉自己变成一只风筝，这样飞的感觉非常好。
It's the 34th time that this competition has been held. It attracts 40 teams from around the world. The event also combines the 13th World Kite Championships. While many come here to unveil their most creative kite designs.After the opening ceremony, the competitors launch their cutting-edge creations. Hey. Yong Xuan has several kites in competition this year, but now it's time to fly his showpiece design.A giant octopus. Several people are needed to hold it down. It's not just flying ability that's judged. Overall design and innovation is also important to winning the competition.
这个呢，一个是比赛按照比赛规则，一个是看它的工艺。工艺呢制作精细，造型呢只有完美，但是起飞呢按照设计要求起飞平稳。这个呢也是看裁判呢，他们也有部分个人喜好。
This year, the odds are in his favor, racking up enough points to steal a win. Not content with that, Yong Xuan also launches a retro wood-framed kite.Inspired by the first ever design. A homegrown invention that spread like a lot of Chinese innovations and pastimes along the Silk Road to the rest of the world. A short distance from Weifang,lies a place that takes full advantage of the wind that shapes this region. Qingdao is now China's competitive sailing capital. After hosting the Olympics in 2008, it's now a venue for many other sailing events, including the biggest outside the America's Cup.
I think, from Qingdao, 2008年以后，他把这个奥运会作为了我们这个帆船的一个基地，也是做了一个极大的推广在中国。
Every year, teams and individuals from all over the world meet here for a leg of the Extreme Sailing Series, the Grand Prix of Sailing. This year, a professional local sailor, Liu Xue, is competing in the Extreme Series for the first time. Unlike many other sailing races, this competition has been designed to be a spectator sport.
极限赛跟其他赛事不同的地方就是它可以很直观的看到这个帆船在你眼前的近距离的去直观的效果特别强。
The Extreme Series began life in 2007, designed around the fastest crafts in the world. These double-hulled foiled catamarans are shipped to each Grand Prix event. This year, 24-year-old Yu has an extra challenge. They are a wildcard team.
我们极限队其实是一支全新的队伍，在赛前刚刚组成的。然后我们有来自三个英国的选手，然后我们有来自一个葡萄牙的选手，还有来自我山东青岛的一个中国的选手。我跟葡萄牙选手在船上是一个联合船长的位置。
Lu is also hoping to inspire the next generation of Chinese sailors who are holding their own small regatta.
你掉下来了，但是你或者是紧急展项，你没在摘挂钩或者什么的，有没有这种情况？
有。
那在水里你紧不紧张啊？
紧张啊！我天，我当时那船往这边斜嘛，往这扣过来了嘛，我摘不下来，然后我就特别
紧张，
特别紧张，就被扣在船里。
15-year-old Niu Qinghua is one of China's up-and-coming sailing hopefuls, which Liu hopes to inspire with his own sporting story.
我希望以后能变成一个和他一样的那个很好的帆船运动员，然后我也会跟他多学习。
啊，因为你我也是，比如说有时候我看到极限的时候，你叫12年的时候，我站在岸上看他们比赛，我从来不敢想我会站在这场比赛。我们的愿望其实也是能够有一天。带领自己带领或者是我们国内的人带领一个纯中国的赛队参加这样国际的赛事。
It's the final race of the day. Being on board an extreme sailing vessel is not for the faint-hearted. They sail at speeds reaching 39 knots or 72 kilometers per hour.
其实当这个船达到一定速度以后，因为我们船上有一个 foil， 其实叫水翼嘛。它会呈现了一定角度，将我们的船推离水面。
Capsizing is always a danger as the sailors push themselves to the limit. It soon becomes a battle between three teams, the lead changing several times. But Liu's team struggles at the back of the field. In the end, the wildcard team finish last. But he's philosophical.
希望他们不管是热爱还是喜欢，还是作为一个体育项目来从事，都是一个很好的一个效果。让他们互相的能够，我们把我们的这个帆船爱好给延续下去，传播下去，让更多的国人知道我们这个帆船运动。帆船这个项目其实不仅仅是一个，体力项目，它也是一个脑力项目，是一个团队协作项目，是一个协调性的项目，对人体的健康也是特别有益的。
In one short generation, China has changed faster than any nation in history through major engineering and construction projects. China is broadening its outlook too.From conservation and celebration of old pastimes. To new sports and leisure activities. Racing to adapt to the 21st century challenges that lie ahead.